Well, this to me is probably the easiest message that I could ever preach because me and him are so close. And I'm not just bragging, I'm just being real with y'all, okay? Me and Holy Spirit are really, really close, okay? And I pray that you're close to the Holy Spirit. And I pray that after today, if you're not close to the Holy Spirit, that you will engage and you will receive him and you'll accept him as your best friend. Not that you get rid of your other ones, okay? It's good to have some, you know, some natural best friends. But this is a best friend that stays with you 24/7, y'all. And this is a best friend that's got more power and more ability and more resources, okay? And knows more people than any of your friends could ever know. Amen? And this person, the Holy Spirit, can actually tap somebody on the shoulder that you don't even know to give you something that you need. Did you know that? That's what's so wonderful about the Holy Spirit. So I want you guys, as we go through this message today, is to begin to think about what your life would look like if Holy Spirit was around you, in you, working through you 24/7. That he was the one you went to first before you called anybody else. He was the one you went to before you talked to your spouse. He was the one that you went to before you talked to your boss. Hey, man, look, I need more money, bro. You ain't paying me enough money. Why don't you go talk to Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and see what he could do? Do you know he can go into places that you can't go in, and he can be more effective than you can be? Amen? He knows how to say things and do things that makes it a lot better. We can go in places and mess it up. Anybody in the house? Anybody done that? Glory to God. I'm going to go in and I'm going to talk to them. I'm just going to, you know, just let them know how I feel. Next thing you know, you walk out going, man, why did I say that? Dadgum, that was stupid. But when we have the Holy Spirit, he helps us. So I'm going to be talking about him today, and I'm going to be talking about him a lot. And I will say this, okay? I don't know what denomination you're from, and I don't care. Okay? I do feel like this year the spirit of I don't care is coming on me. I mean it. Because, again, it's about freedom in Christ. And if I'm up here telling you what I think, then I should care. That's wrong. But if I'm up here standing here and giving you what the Holy Spirit has for you, thus saith the word of the Lord, there will be no shame in my game. Amen? I'm not going to apologize. I'm not going to hold back. Why are you saying that, Pastor? Because I'm getting ready to say some things that is cross-grained to a lot of denominations. And you're going to have to determine, okay, just like, well, I didn't come from a denomination. My denomination was Bud Light, Jim Beam. That was my denomination. That's what I came from. I came from the Church of Hell. Okay? My leader was Satan. He was the one leading my life. So I left that denomination. And I came to Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And I came to his holy written word. That means I didn't have a lot of denominational creeds and beliefs and watered down truths that I had to work through. Amen? I just began to read the Bible and say, wow, I'm going to do what it says. Because if the Bible is for one, the Bible is for all. He didn't give one something and say, oh, sorry, Nathan, you don't get that. No, 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 no. I get everything that Peter, James, and John get, and so do you. So if they got the Holy Spirit and they spoke in tongues, guess what this boy's going to be doing? I'm going to get the Holy Ghost and I'm going to speak in tongues.
Well, I just don't believe in that stuff. I think this stuff's crazy, man. In my church, man, they said that's of the devil. You are no longer at your church, and I'm going to give you scripture after scripture after scripture. Not my opinion. I'm going to give you the word. And at that point, you can determine what you want to do, amen, and how you want to handle it. Hallelujah. But I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit will change your life. And the sad part about it is when you say the Holy Spirit, from the time I got saved in the late 80s and in the 90s, when it seemed like the power of God was on a move like no other, okay, I went to a church to where you never knew what was going to happen. I mean, you'd walk in and they would be carrying people out the door at night because they were so moved by the Spirit of God would come on them. Well, I don't believe in all that falling out stuff. I mean, come on, that's just crazy. Well, you don't believe the Bible. It's all in the Bible. What about Jesus when the soldiers came to get Jesus? And they said, hey, we're looking for Jesus. Where? He said, I am. And all of them fell backwards. That's the power of God coming in contact with human flesh. You going to do something, y'all. How many times do we see an angel appear to men and then they fall to their knees and worship him because of the
They shouldn't have been worshiping the angel, but it was the power of God. It was the presence of Almighty God came in, and it affects your flesh. It affects your being. Amen? You can't stand in the presence of God. You're going to weep. You're going to come to your knees. You're going to fall down. I get it. There is a lot of unnecessary stuff that has happened. There's been a lot of abuse. Okay? There's been people that they go through the line and they push people down. Well, they'll stay with them, and they'll just keep pushing and pushing and pushing until they I know there's abuse. There's always going to be abuse where there's truth. Always. That's never going to change. Amen? As long as you have a devil running around, you're going to have the temptation for there to be flesh involved. But this church is not going to operate like that. Okay? If I pray for you, you'll never see me try to push you down. If I pray for somebody and they fall, that's between them and God, not my assistants. Man, Spirit of God moving here, y'all. Woo! Man, I wish y'all was here. I know y'all need to tune in, man. They falling out like flies. I mean, they are falling, man. Woo! No, we ain't doing all that. No. We ain't up here doing no show. We're going to let the Spirit of God touch humanity. And when the Spirit of God touches humanity, your flesh, my flesh, is going to react to it. You ain't going to stand in the presence of God. Well, now, yeah, if you don't really want it, then you can stand like that. Amen? I got to get something to drink. Hold on. Well, let's go ahead and get into this thing, hallelujah, because I don't want y'all to get nervous. I'm going to do something crazy, okay? Hallelujah. Proverbs 28:20. Now, I want to just share a little bit about what the word of the Lord for the house is. I want to say this over and over again this month, and then I'll probably get away from it for a little while, hallelujah. How many of y'all have enjoyed praying before church? Hey, man, I love that. We're going to do that again next Sunday, okay? I'm not saying we're going to do it all year, but we're going to do it again next Sunday because I like it. I think it sets the tone for the day. So if you would like to, church starts at 10:15, not 10:30. So if you want to come a little early and pray with us, that would be great. Hallelujah. But Proverbs 28:20 says this in the New King James Version. It says, a faithful man will abound with what? Y'all don't have that, so you're doing good. I didn't give y'all that, Michael. But a faithful man, a faithful woman will abound with blessing. Hallelujah. I threw Michael a curveball. Hallelujah. He's good, though. He's good. Glory to God. But Proverbs 28:20, a faithful man, a faithful woman will abound with blessing. The word for 2024 for this house is faithful. Everything we do this year, we're going to be what? Faithful doing it. We're going to be faithful to church, faithful to give, faithful to serve, faithful to love others, faithful to share the good news of Jesus, faithful to live in the fear of God, to study His Word, to have a close relationship with Jesus, faithful to live in for Him no matter what happens in our life, faithful to change the things in our life that He wants us to change, faithful to not make excuses for our wrong behavior, but to obey and never doubt His Word. And there's many other facets to that. You're going to be faithful to your spouse. You're going to be faithful to your kids. You're going to be faithful to your job. Faithful, faithful, faithful. Because it says a faithful man, a faithful woman will abound in what? Cursing? No, blessing. Amen? So God wants to bless His people, but He don't violate His word. So if you're a lazy bum, you ain't going to be blessed. Matter of fact, if you'll read the book of Proverbs, you will see what God thinks about laziness. Not good. Okay? And I'm not going to bless somebody lazy. I'm not going to do it. Now, if you're lazy and you ain't showing no effort to get to work, sorry, not in America. Forget it, man. Come on, get your butt up and get going. No, God is going to bless those that are faithful, and faithful means you're moving to do something. Amen? And you're actively trying to do what God's called you to do. 2024 is going to be a year of the faithful man and woman abounding in the blessing of the Lord. Today, I want to talk to you about being filled with the Holy Spirit. I believe that the Holy Spirit is a gift from God to empower us to walk out the will of God for our lives and to be able to overcome all temptation from the devil. See, the Holy Spirit is called by Jesus to help us walk out this Christian walk. So it really does not, now that I've gotten years of walking with the Holy Spirit and years of serving God, and I've seen people just backslide, I mean, all over the place. They start on fire for God. They start excited about God. And then they fall by the wayside. Okay? And for me personally, I look at it and I just go, after you got saved, did you get filled with the Holy Spirit? Because when you get saved, you don't get filled with the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God goes into you and recreates your dead spirit. Because we're all born sinners, y'all. You and I are born lost and without God. That means we're spiritually dead because of what Adam and Eve did in the garden. So therefore, when we accept Jesus, the Holy Spirit goes into us, which is a miracle, okay? And he recreates our dead spirit and he makes it come alive. So now we're spiritually alive, not spiritually dead any longer. So the Spirit of God goes in and he does a work inside of you, okay? But that don't mean he's living on the inside of you, which we're going to see here. Scripture after scripture after scripture. He does not live inside of you. He did a work in you, but he's not living in you. That's a separate experience altogether. And you're going to see that in the Word of God. Amen? The Spirit of God recreates our spirit and makes us come alive. Okay? But he does not live in us until we accept him to come into us and fill us up. We have to willingly ask the Holy Spirit to come in. And just like this water baptism does not save you, okay? It does not save you. But what happens is the water baptism is an outward expression of an inward reality. It shows everybody what you did privately has now become public. You're letting everybody know what you did. Amen? The water don't save you. The blood saves you. Amen? The water is just to show an outward expression of an inward. You go down, you immerse, you die, and then you're raised to new life in Christ Jesus. It lets everybody know. That's why you bring your family and your friends and everybody gathers around. And, woo! Hallelujah! Okay? You don't leave the water and then go out and get a six-pack. Okay? You leave the water to begin to walk out this new life. But how can you walk out this new life without some help? Have y'all been out there? It's like a lion's den out there, right? There's a lot of demons and devils all around, on your job, everywhere. Your friends, some of your friends might be acting like a devil, amen? And they want to try to drag you back in. So we need something to help us walk this out just like Jesus did. Hallelujah. Because in John chapter 14, verse 12, the Word of God tells us, this is Jesus. See, I tell you the truth. Anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done and even greater works because I'm going to be with the Father. Jesus is expecting me and you to do greater works than him. Not greater works in number, but not greater works individually, but greater works in number. Think about this. Think about what Jesus was able to accomplish in 3.5 years on this earth. I mean, literally, he absolutely changed a region. How many sick people did Jesus heal? How many people, I mean, the books of the world could not contain all of what Jesus did in 3.5 years, y'all. So it bears to think about, what would this world look like if all of us accepted that role of being like Jesus? What would the world look like if we took that same power that he took and did what he did? Makes you wonder how many hospitals you'd need, huh? Jesus never referred somebody to a hospital. They didn't go get in his line and go, oh, man, whoa, that's pretty serious. Okay, hey, man, you follow Luke. Okay, Luke's going to take you right over here. No, the power of God fixes everything, my friend. But the only way the power of God is ever going to touch anybody, we got to get filled with it. Okay? And I want to read a few scriptures. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We are living in the day for these greater works of Jesus to be on full display. We are that generation to see the power of God move in a way that no other generation has ever seen. How many are y'all ready to see that? Woo! Yeah, come on, count me in. Then it is time for us to be filled with the Holy Spirit and power. If we want to see the signs, wonders, and miracles, then we will need to be full of the same power Jesus was filled with. Luke 3:21 says this. One day when the crowds were being baptized, Jesus himself was baptized. As he was praying, the heavens opened and the Holy Spirit in bodily form descended on him like a dove, and a voice from heaven said, "You are my dearly loved son, and you bring great joy to me." So we see Jesus, 30 years old, no miracles, no signs, no wonders up to this point. He goes to meet his cousin, okay, in the river, all right, to be baptized. His cousin, John, said, "Whoa, man, I don't know about this. I don't know if I can do this," okay? He said, no, you got to do this to fulfill scriptures, okay? So he gets baptized with the Holy Spirit, all right? Now we're going to see what the Holy Spirit does in Jesus. It says, we go to the next chapter, Luke 4, verses 1 and 2. It says, then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being tempted for 40 days by the devil. And in those days he ate nothing, and afterwards, when they had ended, he was hungry. I'm hungry on day 19. I would be eating bark off trees if I was that far along. I mean, come on, man. You know what I'm saying? But the Spirit of God led him there for a divine appointment with his daddy. To get filled up with the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus is about to walk out of them woods, and it's never going to be the same again on this planet. Things are getting ready to change when he walks out of these woods. It says in Luke 4, verse 14, just right on down a little bit further. It says, then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went around throughout all the surrounding region. Jesus started his mission for God in the power of the Holy Spirit. This kicked off 3.5 years of signs, wonders, and miracles. He destroyed the devil's works every day after he was filled with the Holy Spirit. And we can do the same thing as Jesus did if we'll receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has the power that you and I need to live out his will for our life. And a lot of times, and again, I get it, if there's one thing the enemy would love to stop, is the power of the Holy Spirit. If there's one person that knows what the power of the Holy Spirit can do, it is the devil and all the demons. They have seen it work over and over and over again. So the one thing he would like to cut off from the church is talking about the Holy Spirit and you being full of him. Because the last thing he wants is a bunch of Jesuses walking around with the Spirit of God on the inside of them doing what Jesus did. He don't want that. And he wants us to just, and a lot of ministers and preachers, okay, have tried to put being saved and being filled at one time all together. And that's a mistake. That's not biblical. Okay? And I'm going to show you in the Bible. I'm not going to give you my opinion. I'm going to show you in the Bible. There is three different baptisms. There's a baptism in the name of Jesus, which is salvation. There's baptism in the Spirit, which is being filled with the Holy Spirit. And there's baptism in water. Hallelujah. Amen. They're all individual experiences. And the major one, okay, so if you get tripped up on tongues and being filled with the Holy Spirit, that's cool, man. We still can be buds. Hey, man, we good. We good, okay? Don't leave the church. Oh, man, I'm cool, man. I'm all right, you know. I mean, I eat like everybody else. I put on clothes like everybody else. We still cool. I'm not weird, all right? But the main thing that you and I need to do is put your faith in Jesus. You want your name registered in heaven, like the song said. Amen? So that's the main thing, all right? That's the thing that will keep you out of eternity, not speaking in tongues or even being baptized in water. Hallelujah. So let's tiptoe through this. Y'all ready? We're going to tiptoe. We're going to take a little journey, okay? Luke 24:49. This is Jesus talking to the disciples. He said, listen carefully. I am sending the promise of my Father, the Holy Spirit, upon you. But you are to remain in the city of Jerusalem until you are clothed, fully equipped with power from where? From on high. So Jesus told them, were the disciples, did they believe in Jesus? Were they saved? Oh, yeah, they were saved, okay? They were absolutely saved. Matter of fact, there was a moment when Jesus was raised from the dead. He visited his disciples, and he breathed on them. Okay? It was them accepting him because they seen the nail-scarred hands. They seen everything, amen? So they had put their faith in Jesus, and now Jesus is telling them, look, bro, you don't go out sharing me and doing what I showed you to do until you receive this power from on high. Acts chapter 1, verse 4. It says, once again, while he was eating with them, so he'd already been with them multiple. It says he was with them like 40 days. Showing them. So they believed in him, okay? He was eating with them. He commanded them, do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised. As I told you before, John baptized with water, but in just a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom? He replied, the Father alone has the authority to set those dates and those times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So we see Jesus telling his disciples, look, go to Jerusalem, get to the upper room, stay put. Holy Spirit is coming to you. You don't have to go get him. He's coming to you. All right? Now, they didn't know how all this was going to happen. Do you notice all of what I've just read? None of it says, hey, the Holy Spirit's going to come in, Belinda, and he's going to come in like a rushing mighty wind, and it's going to be like fire on top of your head, and you're going to start speaking in tongues, Peter. They had no idea what was going to happen. All they know is God said, I'm going to give you power from on high. The Holy Spirit's going to come upon you. So they're in the upper room obeying Jesus, doing what he told them to do. Now look what happened. In Acts chapter 2, verse 1, on the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames of tongue of fire appeared and settled on each of them, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began to do what? Speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. I chose this translation because, again, I think languages ain't as strong as tongues, even though I like tongues. The Holy Spirit came in, rested on it. I like to have seen that, man. Fire on top of the head, and they speaking in tongues. Come on, man. You know, and I guess the reason why I never had no problem agreeing with this, because I've been drunk enough to where I spoke in tongues. You ever been there? Anybody ever been there? Everybody been really drunk? I've been drunk. I've been drunk. You can't hardly tell what somebody's saying. What do you say? I can't hear you, man. So I'm thinking, hey, man, I'm on this, man. I like this, man. This God's really cool. I like it. The first thing I liked is the church. I mean, they jumping around, shouting, screaming, hollering. I'm thinking, whoa, man, this is happening here because this is what you do at a party. So I thought, man, God's good. Amen. So when I got the opportunity to receive this, I said yes. And that's why nobody can beat it out of me, because I've already experienced it, okay? That's like telling somebody there's no water in the pool, but yet they're soaking wet. Too late, brother. I'm already wet. But I remember the day whenever the man asked me, he said, you want to get saved? I said, yeah. So I received Jesus in his living room. All right? David Cundiff, I'll never forget it, man. It's a memory etched in my life. Hallelujah. And then we got done, and I felt so good with that. He said, now do you want to receive the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues? Yeah, let's roll, baby. Let's do this thing, man. I'm raw. I'm new. I ain't been going this maybe a few months. But this sounds cool. So I actually prayed the prayer, and out of my belly, it just started coming up, coming up. And then all of a sudden, something started coming out of my mouth. And I was like, whoa, dude. Now, did the Holy Spirit grab my tongue and start talking for me? Mm-mm-mm. Yeah, man, I'll receive the Holy Spirit when he makes me. Ain't going to happen. Let me introduce you to my best friend again. He don't make you do nothing. He's a perfect gentleman. He will never, ever make you do anything. You have to step out by faith to do this. It's not something that's just going to happen. But just like this water is an outward expression of an inward reality, you speaking in tongues is an outward expression of what you just got filled with. I want you to grab a hold of that. Okay? And how many people have said no to the Holy Spirit because they didn't understand it? How many preachers, how many denominations have just excused it altogether because they don't understand it? Now again, you're going to heaven, and a lot of people have got saved in a lot of these denominations, and I say, woo-hoo, we don't argue over it. We're not going to fuss and fight over it. We're not going to put somebody down because they're not filled with the Holy Spirit here or anywhere else. You don't have to be filled with the Spirit. You don't have to speak in tongues, okay? It is absolutely an option that I would recommend because it will change your life. And I want you to see what it did in these people's life. Acts chapter 2, verse 14, it says, then Peter, after he got filled with the Holy Spirit, stepped forward with the 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd, listen carefully, all of you, fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem, make no mistake about this. These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. It is much too early for that. No, What you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Acts 2, verse 43 says, a deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. We see in the very same chapter, they got filled with the Spirit, just like Jesus got filled with the Spirit. And they actually started duplicating exactly what Jesus was doing. They were on a mission. But from the time of, I guess, about 90 or whatever, 33, 34 A.D. until 2024, there's been a huge gap. So we've been able to make up a lot of wrong doctrine along the way and absolutely yield to the devil and take the power out of the church and substitute it with other things. There is no substitution for the power of God. Amen? The power of God is what ignites you as a believer. It's what keeps you on fire for God. I'm going to tell you, when you see a sign and a wonder, it keeps you wondering. Amen? It keeps you fired up. Glory to God. So I have not seen one here yet. Okay, we've seen people healed and delivered, and we've seen God do some things. But I brought an old friend of mine to church. Hallelujah. Me and old R.W. Shambach. Okay? And again, he preached way longer than I did. Now he's in heaven. He died in 2012. But I brought one of his testimonies that he witnessed firsthand. He didn't do it, but he watched it. And I want you to hear the story from his lips of what that looked like and what God did with a man full of the Holy Spirit. So let's watch this.
I had young Carlos, who's been driving me around, brought me from the airport. And he said, Brother Shambach, what's the greatest miracle you ever saw? I said, dude, you got 3 hours. And I gave him the short version of it. And this is when I believe that God opened the veil and allowed me to look into the future. We were in Birmingham, Alabama, when I was with Brother Allen, and a woman brought a little boy in 4 years of age who was born with 26 diseases. He had no male organs on his body. He was born blind and deaf and dumb. His tongue hanged out of his mouth and lay on his chin. Both arms and legs were twisted together and matted together. The elbows penetrated into his little tummy. His knees touched the elbows and he had no feet. Clubs, you don't put shoes on clubs, you put shoes on feet. The mother brought that child in. I wrote the card out. I gave it to her in the afternoon service. I was preaching faith, and she was there all week long. But the card was never called. Sometimes we get in too big of a hurry. We run into church, quick preacher, lay hands on me. Bible says lay hands suddenly on no man. Some people need to sit down and hear the word of God preached. And they need to get those preconceived opinions and them doctrines of devils that they have in their brain. And they need to hear the unadulterated word of God, that God's not dead, but he's alive. And he's the same today as he was yesterday. That woman sat there with that boy 3 services a day. She came from another city like you did. Following Sunday, she came after I preached in the afternoon. She said, Brother Shambach, I run out of money. Have you ever been there? She said, my boy hadn't been prayed for yet. I said, I refuse to apologize for the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost used Brother Allen in a different way. And every night he would minister, but it was in a different vein, and he didn't call the prayer card. But she said, I've been staying in the hotel. I've been eating in restaurants. I've been giving in the offering 3 times a day, and I'm down to my last $20. I've got to go home tonight. Can you do something? I said, I can do one thing. If he don't call that prayer card tonight, I'll take that boy over to his trailer house and make him lay hands on that baby. I'll get him to the man of God. Meant that. I would have done it. I was leading the singing that night. And introduced Brother Allen, and he popped out on the stage. And he said, we're going to receive an offering tonight quickly. It's going to be an offering of faith. Don't get nervous. I'm not going to take another one. But I might. And when he said, I want you to give an offering of faith, a puzzled look came on the faces of everybody, including me. I never heard him use that terminology before. And he said, now, if you don't know what I mean by an offering of faith, he said, I want you to give God something you can't afford to give. Because if you can afford it, there's no faith attached to it. Logical? Never heard that expression? The first thing I saw was that little woman. Had the baby in her hand, tossed in another woman's arms, and she come running. She was three-fourths of the way back, and she beat everybody down there. He was holding the bucket. And I saw that woman come running fast. I mean, ran. 3,000 people in that auditorium. And she threw something in the bucket. I'm on the platform. I'm nosy now. I jumped off that platform. And I looked in that bucket. Because that woman told me all she had was that $20 bill. And when I looked in that bucket, you know what I saw in that bucket? $20. She's in Birmingham, Alabama, and she lives in Knoxville, Tennessee. But she wanted a miracle. She needed something from God. She said, Lord, I'll walk home if you just heal my baby. When I saw that $20 bill, I ran behind the platform and I cried like a baby. I said, oh, God, I've been trying to teach that woman faith all week. But I said, oh, God, give me faith like that woman's got. I don't know whether I could do that. You don't know whether you can do it unless you're in a similar situation. That man of God received the offering, started preaching. He wasn't 15 minutes into that service when all of a sudden he said, I see a big building. I said, oh, Lord, here we go on another trip. This is how God used him. He said, it's a big old white building. I'm sitting there unmoved because I hear it all the time. He said, I'm inside the building now. And he said, there's no doubt where I am. He said, I hear all them babies crying. It's the maternity ward in this hospital. He said, a little baby was born. He said, I see 12 doctors around him. He said, that little baby was born with 12, 14, 21, 20, 26 major diseases. And when he said that, I sat up and I said, my God, tonight's that baby's night. Tonight's that baby's night. He said, the doctor said the baby wouldn't live to see its first birthday. But he said, the doctor's wrong. He said, that baby's approaching four. He said, I see mother stuffing a suitcase. She's going on a trip. Another lady's with her. Put the baby in a bassinet. It's in the back seat of an old Ford. He said, I see the Tennessee-Alabama border. He said, that car's pulling in on the parking lot. He said, lady, you're here tonight. Bring me your baby now. God's going to give you 26 miracles. Now. Ooh. Not tomorrow, Benny. Now. God's going to give you 26 miracles. That little woman brought that baby. 4 years of age, put it in the man of God's hands, and he started to walk back and forth on that platform. I leaped from my seat and walked with him. 3,000 people stood to their feet. He said, I want everybody to close your eyes and pray with me. I said, not me, mister. I'm going to watch this one. I've been waiting all week for this. And don't you all look so sanctified. You're just like I am. You want to see something too? And I'm standing there right next to him. And the first thing I saw was that tongue laying on the chin, snapped like a rubber band. And it went in his mouth for the first time in 4 years. Those little blind eyes, you didn't know whether they were blue or brown or what color they were, because it was nothing but milky, solid milk. You knew the boy was blind, couldn't see. But I saw two whirlpools in those eyes. And all of a sudden, you could see brand new blue eyes coming through the milky colored condition. Are you listening to me? I'm talking about a God that's not dead, but a God that's alive. Hallelujah. anointing. The next thing I saw was those arms and legs began to snap simultaneously as they kicked out for the first time. Standing there in front of those people, there's no shoes on clubs. Those clubs were there. But I saw God create feet on that little boy's legs. I used to buy my children, we used to buy them silly putty when they were kids. I don't know whether they have that now or not, but they used to make things out of that stuff. And it just looked like God was using silly putty to put a foot on the end of that boy's body. People's hands were raised. Some were fallen under the power. Some that didn't go down fell down. I mean, we knew we were in the presence of an awesome God. Faith had nothing to do with this. This was God working in the midst of his people. This was a sovereign act of God. Mama standing over here on this side of the platform with her hands raised, tears streaming down her face. He put the child down. This boy never saw his mama, never spoke, never walked, never talked. And when he put that boy down, he took his first little steps. And when he saw mama, he ran after her. I'm running after him. He leaped into his mama's arms, wrapped his arms around her, and I heard him say his first words, "Mama, mama, 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 mama." Twelve wheelchairs, you in wheelchairs, listen to me. You that are watching by television, I want you to hear it. 12 wheelchairs on this side of the platform. Like a sergeant commanded all 12 of them to stand at attention, all 12 stood up at one time. And they walked out of those wheelchairs. Some spinal cords were broken, severed because of motorcycle accidents. 3,000 people watching what was taking place. And all of a sudden, like a maestro leading a great chorus, every eye went to the stretcher case. 13, 14 stretchers on this side, like they knew what was going to happen. Everybody in those wheelchairs got up and walked out totally healed. While we're standing on the platform, people began to file down the aisle. Back in those days, in 1957, the hearing aids were like transistor radios. They were pulling them out of their ears and out of their pockets where they had them. And there were 24 of them laying on the platform. They didn't need them any longer. People started taking glasses off and laying them on the platform. Every cane, every crutch, and every walker, they were bringing them down, walking normally. They were healed while they were seated out there. I always say nobody laid hands on them, but somebody did lay hands on them. It was the nail-scarred hand of Calvary that night. Can you shout amen? Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Here comes a half a dozen people with different parts of the congregation. Six white canes with 6 inches of red at the bottom. Totally blind, and their eyes popped open. Women lost 4 and 5 dress sizes when tumors just disappeared. Every person in the building was healed. Every person was healed, a divine, sovereign act of God. And people ask me, why? How? Why did it happen like that? I can't but have one answer, that God lifted the veil to show me what he's going to do in this last day. Oh, hallelujah. I said hallelujah. It's not going to be 2 out of 10 or 3 out of 7. It's not going to be 8 out of 10. But I believe we're living in the day when everybody's going to get healed by the power of God. No man will take glory for it, but it'll be God working through his people. You are the anointed. ones of God. Can you raise your hands and shout amen?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We reverence you, Holy Spirit. You know, A.A. Allen is dead and gone. He's no longer here. William Seymour in the late 1900s, early 1900s, he's dead and gone. He's no longer here. Smith Wigglesworth, dead and gone. But you know who ain't dead? God. And did you hear what that man said? That God let him see what it was going to look like in the last days. And man, I'm telling you, what breaks my heart is there's churches today that you can walk in and walk out and you'll never be introduced to the power of God. There's churches that our kids have been raised in and they've never seen that right there. Not on my watch. I'm changing. This church is changing or it won't be here. I mean that with all my heart. I'm going after what the Holy Spirit did there and what's been promised to us is this generation. I mean, I can promise you right now, you can't put on your hand five churches that you could walk into right now and get prayer for healing. Right now. Without being told, hey, look, what we'll get with you a little later on. Won't you, hey, ushers, we'll pray for him in the back there. See, these old men of God that would get tense. You know, the thing I liked about A.A. Allen is because he was preaching in the days when segregation was huge. I mean, they literally would come to the tent and they'd have black here, white here. One of the first white preachers to hire a black worship leader and break down those walls. And you begin to see black and white all through his tents. But he was a man, I was listening to his son talk about. He was a man that loved people. He was a man that loved to see people get saved. He was a man that wanted to see the power of God change his generation. And there was no walls that was going to stop him. Friend, it's time for there to be a church of signs, wonders, and miracles. It's time for a church to rise up and be in a neighborhood, in a community that is not in a hurry to leave at 12 o'clock. Not in a hurry to come in and do three songs and a message, collect the tithes and run out the door so we can go enjoy a life that's miserable. It's time for us to create a place where the Holy Spirit can come and abide and we're not in a hurry. That woman drove from Knoxville, Tennessee, gave all she had for her baby to get healed. I wonder if you could talk her out of the Holy Spirit and power ain't real. I wonder if you could just talk to her and say, oh, this is just a bunch of made-up stuff. And what I desire is to run with people that are not ashamed of the Holy Spirit and His power. That we don't run from this, we run to it. And I'll be honest with you guys, I can't do church. I can't do it. It ain't happening. I can't. These are going to be Holy Ghost services. I know as a pastor I've got to teach about things, and I will. But there's going to be an element of the Holy Spirit and power at every service we do. And if that's uncomfortable for you, I could give you a list mile long of some churches you can walk in and walk out, and you'll never be noticed. Never. You can walk in and walk out with your sin and everything else, and nobody will say a word. Matter of fact, they'll put you on a lead team. Not here. Not here. I want people to feel the weight of their sin when they walk through that door, that they need to change and they need to come to a Savior that died for them, bled for them, went to hell for them. But not just that, a Savior that wants to heal them. I'm serious, guys. I'm tired of people. This church will never be that church that refers people. Oh, you're dealing with some mental things. Yeah, well, I got a good psychiatrist. No, never. You dealing with some mental things? Let me introduce you to the one that can fix your mental things. And we're going to pray, and we're going to see God, and we're going to watch God do some things. How many of y'all want to see that too? How many of y'all want to see these things? Amen? I mean, I want to bring family and friends, hallelujah, to church, and they see the move of God. Not some great music and some preacher get up there all slick back like Slick Willie with his hair back and he's got his nice clothes on and having 14 services in a day and ain't nothing hitting somebody in the heart and driving out sickness and disease that's trying to kill them and their family? Come on, man. No, man. Jesus died so we would be Jesus on the earth. And if Jesus was concerned about people that were hurting and broken and sick and afflicted, shouldn't we be? Or should we just see how short we can make the service and how quick we can do things so we can just say, hey, we went to church. No. Sorry, I'm done with that. So again, if that's the church you're looking for, give me a hug on your way out and say it's been a good ride. We've had a good ride with you, Pastor. But I'm telling you, this guy is going deeper and harder, and I'm going to see signs, wonders, and miracles. You're going to see signs, wonders, and miracles. We're going to see His Spirit cover Henry County like it does the water on the seashores. Amen? That's what we're going after. Amen? That's been my prayer point through this whole 21 days. I want to see signs, wonders, and miracles. I want to see the Spirit of God move. Did you notice what He said? That nobody will get the glory. Nobody's going to get the attention. Only God's going to get the attention. Did you hear what He said about people that were falling out under the power? People were getting out of the wheelchairs and ain't nobody touched them? Was that just for them in that day? No. It takes preachers. It takes a congregation that's willing to resurrect that and say, God, You are not like what we see. You're greater than that. Amen? And the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, the same Spirit that came in these apostles on the day of Pentecost is the same Spirit that wants to come into you and me. So we see on the day of Pentecost, the Spirit of God came down to equip them, to empower them, to do the very work that Jesus did while He was on the earth. And can we honestly say that we're really true in doing the work of God? Be real, man. Let's all be real. I'll be the first to say no. We're not. And that's why serving Christ is boring. That's why serving Christ ain't got no excitement to it. That's why people can come in and they can sit down and they can just hear a message and, you know, yeah, that's good. Boy, he's really charismatic. Man, he's got a lot of energy. Boy, he's passionate. Wow, that dude, he's excited about God. Man, I give him that. And then get up and leave. And nothing's changed in their heart. Because it's man trying to impress man. It's people trying to do church to impress people. I'm done with that. I'm done with it. Because there ain't nothing. If I have to impress you to come here, I'll have to impress you to keep you here. And the weight of that's too much. I ain't got time for it. And you may say, well, man, your church is really small. I mean, my God, I mean, these bigger churches, they're seeing salvations. They're saying, yeah, and we're all for them. Like I said, we're not putting anybody down. Jesus didn't go around putting down other people. Matter of fact, He even told His disciples. The disciples came to Him one time and said, hey, Master, they're casting out devils over here. Jesus said, whoa, time out. If they're doing the work of God, don't get on to them. They're with us. They're not against us. No, we got plenty of friends around here that are doing great things and seeing people get saved. My problem is the back door sometimes as big as the front door. They come in, they get saved, and then they leave and go back out to the world. Why didn't I? Young man got saved, went through a divorce, been through things in my life. I could have went out and went back into the world. Why didn't I? Why? Because when I called my buddy up to come and get me, there was a power that was in me that kept me and didn't let me go. And that's the power I want all of y'all to have. Oh, Pastor, man, I'm just struggling with some things. Get the power in you. Just let him come in. Quit trying to figure out, well, I just don't know what I can say. Don't worry about that. Just say, Holy Spirit, come. Feel me. And then just begin to open up your mouth and talk. What's that look like? Do you know I can pray in the Spirit? And my mind don't understand, but I'm talking to God. I can communicate to Him. So when I go into prayer, this is what that looks like. Father, I just thank You in the name of Jesus. Now, I pray in English too, okay? Father, I thank You. I thank You for this opportunity to come to You and worship You. Now, Father, I'm going to pray to You in my heavenly language. And as I do, I know, Father God, this is a direct line to You. And I know You're going to download things into me that nobody knows. There'll be no interference. It's just me and You talking. I'm going to let my spirit communicate with Your spirit. And You set this up. So I'm just going to open up my mouth. And I'm going to begin speaking. And I thank You, Lord, that as I do, You somehow are going to be depositing things and doing things in my heart that English can't bring. And the enemy's not even going to know what I'm going to say. So, Father, here I go. I'm just going to pray to You. Did it start out that way? No, it didn't start out that way. I don't know what I sounded like, really, when I first started. But I remember my friends making fun of me, one in particular, when I was a painter at the time. And I'd go to work, and I said, man, I got filled with the Holy Ghost, man. I'm speaking in tongues. And he began to start making fun of me, walking around the house, mocking me big time. God didn't kill him. But a short time after that, he pulled out to go to work, and a car didn't see him on his motorcycle and knocked him about 170-something feet in the air, crushed one whole half of his body, and he died. God didn't do it. He opened the door for the enemy to do it. So I've got a directive this morning. And my directive is, if you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, I'm going to do exactly what Paul did in Acts chapter 19, verse 1. It said, while Apollos was in Corinth, Paul traveled through the interior regions until he reached Ephesus on the coast, where he found several believers. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Or he could have said, did you receive the Holy Spirit since you've been saved? He asked them. No, they replied. We hadn't even heard that there was a Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. Then what baptism did you experience? He asked. They replied, the baptism of John. They weren't even saved. And you're going to see that right here. Paul said, John's baptism called for repentance from sin, but John himself told the people to believe in the one who would come later, meaning Jesus. That's salvation. As soon as they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. That was salvation. Then when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in other tongues and prophesied. So we see that many, many years after the day of Pentecost, we're seeing a method here. We're seeing something happen. That we're seeing people getting filled with the Holy Spirit after the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 10, Cornelius was a Roman centurion. He was a Gentile. It came to the Gentiles. We're seeing salvation come to the Gentiles, which is the rest of the world except the Jews. Then we're seeing the Holy Spirit being poured out on all flesh. We're seeing this. We're seeing a move of God like no other. And just like it was good for them there, it's good for us today. You may say, well, what's the deal with all these tongues, man? Why do we got to have these tongues? 1 Corinthians 14, verse 2. Here's Paul speaking. For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men but to God. For no one understands him. However, in the Spirit he speaks mysteries. But he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. He who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. But he who prophesies edifies the church. I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you would prophesy, for he who prophesies is greater than he speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets that the church may receive edification. That's why when I come in here, I don't really pray in tongues with a microphone, unless I'm going to interpret it, because it can bring confusion to those that don't understand it. My praying in tongues is for me and God. Now, there is a special gift the Holy Spirit gives. It's called tongues and interpretation of tongues. So if I get up here and I pray out of tongue, and then Belinda gives y'all the interpretation, that is biblical. And you say, Pastor, you know, all this stuff sounds weird. I know. I get it, bro. I get it. But I'm not God. And you think about it. Had he done it in a way that we could understand it, would that have took faith? Think about it. What did the man of God say? He said that giving, give what you don't have. Because if you give what you can give, you ain't really operating in faith. It's when you step out beyond you, that's when you tap into the God. Hallelujah. Paul goes on to 1 Corinthians 14:13, same chapter. He says, therefore, let him who speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, my understanding is unfruitful. What is the conclusion then? I will pray with the spirit, and I will also pray with the understanding. I will sing with the spirit, and I will also sing with the understanding. 1 Corinthians 14:18. I thank God, this is Paul, that I speak in tongues more than you all. 1 Corinthians 14:39-40. So, my dear brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy and don't forbid speaking in tongues. So that's why I say that there's a lot of ministries, a lot of ministers that forbid people to do this. They talk down on it. Just because you don't understand it, and you may be here today, you may say, Pastor, look, I need a little bit more time to process this. I get it. Do it. Take your time. There's nobody going to make anybody, okay? All right? And don't feel bad if you don't come up here to get prayed for or if you don't want to take that step today. Don't condemn. Listen, there's no shame. There's no condemnation. We're all walking this journey together, okay? There'll be a time when you may feel like it may be this morning. It may be a week or 2 weeks from now. It may be in the privacy of your own home. Your husband just lay hands on you. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Or your wife lay hands on you. This is not about calling people out to put you on the spot. Ain't none of that going on. This is just about you deciding, do I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit? I'm not going to make you. I'm going to lay my hands on you. And we're going to believe that God does the rest. Hallelujah. Ephesians 5:18 says, don't be drunk with wine because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. And then Jude 20. And we'll end it here. But you, dear friends, must build each other up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. This is vital to your walk with God. And I can promise you, if the enemy could do anything, he wants to confuse this. He wants to stamp it out of churches. He don't want it to be talked about. Why? Because this, okay, is meant to edify you, build you up, make you stronger, put you in a position to where you and God are talking one-on-one and the enemy can't get in. It's about you praying through things that may happen 10 years from now. I'm telling you, it will change your life, friend. And some of y'all have been filled with the Holy Spirit, but you just have not been speaking in other tongues. You have not been using your private prayer language because you've been too busy. You've had other things going on. But I'll tell you, if you want to have a Christian life that's adventurous, get filled with the Holy Spirit. And I promise you, the things you struggle with, you won't struggle with them. I'll tell you, he gets in you, he fills you up, he drives stuff out. If there's anything you want inside of you, it's not a cheeseburger. That's good. And I'd really like to have one right now. But you want the Holy Spirit on there, on the inside of your heart, working through you and in you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just come before you in the name of Jesus. Everybody close your eyes. Hallelujah. Again, being filled with the Holy Spirit is not something to be scared of. Not at all. Man, the Holy Spirit is such a gentleman. He's so sweet. But he wants to be in you. He wants to be in you. And for those that he has been in you, the Bible talks, if you go through Acts, there was many times that they would be filled and filled and filled throughout the book of Acts. I mean, how many of you guys go to a gas station and fill up and that's the last time you ever get gas? No. You run out of gas, you got to go get more gas. It's the same thing with many in this room. Some of y'all in this room are filled with the Spirit, but you've been struggling. And it's because you're not praying in the Spirit. you're trying to just go through life and pray in English and just fight your way through it and try to make it happen on your own. No, no, no. Don't do it. You can't live this life on your own. But before I ask anybody that wants to be filled to come up, I want to first give the invitation. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you have never put your faith in Jesus, today's your day to do that. That's the most important thing you'll do, is to say yes to Jesus Christ. Maybe you're in this room and you've said yes to Jesus Christ, but man, you're living a hypocritical life. You're not living for God. You may say you love God. You may say you love Jesus and you believe in Him, but your life is saying something else. That's a backslidden life, and God wants to get you away from that. So if you want to receive Christ or you want to come back to Christ, today is your day to do that. And I want to just pray with you. So if that's you and you want that, then just raise your hand. Hallelujah. Just raise your hand. Say, Pastor, pray for me. Yes, I want to receive Jesus. My life ain't right. My life is not right. I want to receive Him, or I want to come back to Him on any of those occasions. Hallelujah. Jesus is here to receive you, to save you. Hallelujah. But if you're saved and you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, I want to give you the invitation to come and be filled with the Holy Spirit.